This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Columbia River is the largest river in the Pacific Northwest region of North America. The river rises in the Rocky Mountains of British Columbia, Canada. It flows northwest and then south into the U.S. state of Washington, then turns west to form most of the border between Washington and the state of Oregon before emptying into the Pacific Ocean. The river is 1,243 miles 2,000. Past centuries, indigenous peoples traveled across western North America to the Columbia to trade for fish. In the late 18th century, a private American ship became the first non-indigenous vessel to enter the river. It was followed by a British explorer, who navigated past the Oregon Coast Range into the Willamette Valley in the following decades. Fur trading companies used the Columbia as a key transportation route. Overland explorers entered the Willamette Valley through the scenic but treacherous Columbia River Gorge, and pioneers began to settle the valley in increasing numbers, following both routes to enter it. Steamships along the river linked communities and facilitated trade. The arrival of railroads in the late 19th century, many running along the river, supplemented these links. Since the late 19th century, public and private sectors have heavily developed the river. The development, commonly referred to as taming or harnessing of the river, has been massive and multi-faceted to aid ship and barge navigation. Locks have been built along the lower Columbia and its tributaries, and dredging has opened, maintained, and enlarged shipping channels since the early 20th century. Dams have been built across the river for the purposes of power generation, navigation, irrigation, and flood control. Today, a dam-impounded reservoir lies along nearly every U.S. mile of the once free-flowing river, and much of the Canadian stretch has been impounded as well. Production of nuclear power has taken place at two sites along the river. Plutonium for nuclear weapons was produced for decades at the Hanford site, which is now the most contaminated nuclear site in the U.S. All these developments have had a tremendous impact on river environments, mainly through industrial pollution and barriers to fish migration. Contents 1 Course 11 Discharge 2 Geology 3 Indigenous Peoples 4 New Waves of Explorers 5 Navigation 51 Opening the Passage to Lewiston 52 Deeper Shipping Channel 6 Dams 61 Irrigation 62 Hydroelectricity 7 Ecology and Environment 71 Fish Migration 72 Pollution 8 Watershed 81 Major Tributaries 9 See also 10 Notes and References 11 Further Reading 12 External Links Course The Columbia begins its 1,243-mile 2,000. The Kootenay River, and Trail, two major population centers of the West Kootenay region. The Penned Oreille River joins the Columbia about 2 miles 3. The Columbia in the Tri-Cities Population Center. The Columbia makes a sharp bend to the west at the Washington-Oregon border. The river defines that border for the final 309 miles 497. Ships. The Columbia drains an area of about 258,000 square miles 670,000. Measured at the Dalles, was 1,240,000 cubic feet per second 35,000. Creation of the Pacific Northwest between 150 and 90. Occurred between about 19,000 and 13,000. Bonneville slide anywhere between 1060 and 1760 AD. The idea that the landslide debris present today was formed by more than one slide is relatively recent and may explain the large range of estimates. It has been suggested that if the later dates are accurate, there may be a link with the 1700 Cascadia earthquake. The pile of debris resulting from the Bonneville slide blocked the river until rising water finally washed away the sediment. It is not known how long it took the river to break through the barrier. Estimates range from several months to several years. Much of the landslide's debris remained, forcing the river about 15 miles 24. At the Marms Rock Shelter, near the confluence of the Palouse and Snake Rivers in eastern Washington in 1996, the skeletal remains of a 9,000-year-old prehistoric man dubbed Kennewick Man were found near Kennewick, Washington. The discovery rekindled debate in the scientific community over the origins of human habitation in North America and sparked a protracted controversy over whether the scientific or Native American community was entitled to possess and/or study the remains. Many different Native Americans and First Nations peoples have a historical and continuing presence on the Columbia south of the Canada-U.S. by the Sinixt people, who live in the area of the Arrow Lakes in the river's upper reaches in Canada. All three terms essentially mean the Big River. Oral histories describe the formation and destruction of the Bridge of the Gods, a land bridge that connected the Oregon and Washington sides of the river in the Columbia River Gorge. The bridge, which aligns with geological records of the Bonneville Slide, was described in some stories as the result of a battle between gods, represented by Mount Adams and Mount Hood, in their competition for the affection of a goddess, represented by Mount St. Main conduit through which horses and the plains culture diffused into the Columbia River region. Other peoples acquired horses and aspects of the plains culture unevenly. The Yakima, Umatilla, Pallas, Spokane, and Coeur d'Alene maintained sizable herds of horses and adopted some of the plains cultural characteristics, but fishing and fish-related economies remained important. Less affected groups included the Malala, Klickitat, Wenatchee, Okanagan, and Tsingkayus Columbia peoples, who owned small numbers of horses and adopted few plains culture features. Some groups remained essentially unaffected, such as the Sandpoil and Nispelum people, whose culture remained centered on fishing. Natives of the region encountered foreigners at several times and places during the 18th. Contact with Westerners. The natives of the Mid and Lower Columbia were not tribal, but instead congregated in social units no larger than a village, and more often at a family level. These units would shift with the season as people moved about, following the salmon catch up and down the river's tributaries sparked by the 1848 Whitman Massacre. A number of violent battles were fought between American settlers and the region's natives. The subsequent Indian Wars, especially the Yakima War, decimated the native population and removed much land from native control. As years progressed, the right of natives to fish along the Columbia became the central issue of contention with the states, commercial fishers, and private property owners. The U.S. Supreme Court upheld fishing rights in landmark cases in 1905 and 1918, as well as the 1974 case United States v. Washington, commonly called the Bolt decision. Dipnet fishing at Celilo Falls, 1941. Fish were central to the culture of the region's natives, both as sustenance and as part of their religious beliefs. Natives drew fish from the Columbia at several major sites, which also served as trading posts. Celilo Falls, located east of the modern city of the Dalles, was a vital hub for trade and the interaction of different cultural groups, being used for fishing and trading for 11,000. Drew traders from as far away as the Great Plains. The Cascades Rapids of the Columbia River Gorge, and Kettle Falls and Priest Rapids in eastern Washington, were also major fishing and trading sites in prehistoric times. The Columbia's salmon and steelhead runs numbered an estimated annual average of 10 to 16. Warm Springs, a coalition of various tribes, adopted a constitution and incorporated after the 1938 completion of the Bonneville Dam flooded Cascades Rapids. Still, in the 1930s, there were natives who lived along the river and fished year-round, moving along with the fish's migration patterns throughout the seasons. The Yakima were slower to do so, organizing a formal government in 1944 in the 21st. Whether they landed near the Columbia, evidence exists that Spanish castaways reached the shore in 1679 and traded with the Clatsop. If these were indeed the first Europeans to see the Columbia, they failed to send word home to Spain in the 18th. Color, but he accepted Meer's report and continued on his journey northward. Later that month, Vancouver encountered the American captain Robert Gray at the Strait of Juan de Fuca. Gray reported that he had seen the entrance to the Columbia and had spent 9 days trying but failing to enter. On May 12, 1792, Gray returned south and crossed the Columbia Bar, becoming the first explorer to enter the river. Gray's fur trading mission had been financed by Boston merchants, who outfitted him with a private vessel named Columbia Redaviva. He named the river after the ship. On May 18, Gray spent 9 days trading near the mouth of the Columbia, then left without having gone beyond 13 miles 21. Visible on the left detail from the Lewis and Clark expedition map. The Willamette River is shown as the Multnomah, while the Snake River is Lewis River. See complete map. Because the Columbia was at the same latitude as the headwaters of the Missouri River, there was some speculation that Gray and Vancouver had discovered the long-sought Northwest Passage. A 1798 British map showed a dotted line connecting the Columbia with the Missouri when the American explorers Meriwether Lewis and William Clark charted the vast, unmapped lands of the American West in their overland Greenland Expedition 1803-05, they found no passage between the rivers after crossing the Rocky Mountains. Lewis and Clark built dugout canoes and paddled down the Snake River, reaching the Columbia near the present-day Tri-Cities, Washington. They explored a few miles upriver, as far as Bateman Island, before heading down the Columbia, concluding their journey at the river's mouth and establishing Fort Clatsop, a short-lived establishment that was occupied for less than 3 months. Canadian explorer David Thompson, of the Northwest Company, spent the winter of 1807-08 at Kootenay House near the source of the Columbia at present-day Invermere, British Columbia. Over the next few years he explored much of the river and its northern tributaries. In 1811 he traveled down the Columbia to the Pacific Ocean, arriving at the mouth just after John Jacob Astor's Pacific Fur Company had founded Astoria. On his return to the north, Thompson explored the one remaining part of the river he had not yet seen, becoming the first European American to travel the entire length of the river. In 1825, the Hudson's Bay Company HBC established Fort Vancouver on the bank of the Columbia, in what is now Vancouver, Washington, as the headquarters of the company's Columbia District, which encompassed everything west of the Rocky Mountains. John McLaughlin, a physician, was appointed chief factor of the Columbia District. The HBC reoriented its Columbia District operations toward the Pacific Ocean via the Columbia, which became the region's main trunk route. In the early 1840s, Americans began to colonize the Oregon country in large numbers via the Oregon Trail. Despite the HBC's efforts to discourage American settlement in the region, for many the final leg of the journey involved travel down the lower Columbia River to Fort Vancouver. This part of the Oregon Trail, from the Dalles to Fort Vancouver, was the trail's most treacherous stretch, which prompted the 1846 construction of the Barlow Road. In the Treaty of 1818, the United States and Britain agreed that both nations were to enjoy equal rights in Oregon country for 10 region. In the 1840s, a mass migration of American settlers undermined British control. The Hudson's Bay Company tried to maintain dominance by shifting from the fur trade, which was in sharp decline, to exporting other goods such as salmon and lumber. Colonization schemes were attempted, but failed to match the scale of American settlement. Americans generally settled south of the Columbia, mainly in the Willamette Valley. The Hudson's Bay Company tried to establish settlements north of the river, but nearly all the British colonists moved south to the Willamette Valley. The hope that the British colonists might dilute the American flavor of the valley failed in the face of the overwhelming number of American settlers. These developments rekindled the issue of joint occupation and the boundary dispute. While some British interests, especially the Hudson's Bay Company, fought for a boundary along the Columbia River, the Oregon Treaty of 1846 set the boundary at the 49th. Navigation. See also, Steamboats of the Columbia River, Steamboats of the Columbia River, Wenatchee Reach, and Shipwrecks of the Inland Columbia River. The mouth of the Columbia is just past Astoria, Oregon. Ships must navigate the treacherous Columbia Bar near horizon, not visible in this picture, to enter or exit the river. The Sternwheeler Hassalo runs the Cascades Rapids. May 26, 1888. The rapids are now submerged under the pool of the Bonneville Dam. Benson massive log raft containing an entire year's worth of logs from one timber camp heads downriver. In 1906, American Captain Robert Gray and British Captain George Vancouver, who explored the river in 1792, proved that it was possible to cross the Columbia Bar. Many of the challenges associated with that feat remain today, even with modern engineering alterations to the mouth of the river. The strong currents and shifting sandbar make it dangerous to pass between the river and the Pacific Ocean. The use of steamboats along the river, beginning with the British Beaver in 1836 and followed by American vessels in 1850, contributed to the rapid settlement and economic development of the region. Steamboats operated in several distinct stretches of the river, on its lower reaches, from the Pacific Ocean to Cascades Rapids, from the Cascades to Celilo Falls, from Celilo to the confluence with the Snake River, on the Wenatchee Reach of eastern Washington, on British Columbia's Arrow Lakes, and on tributaries like the Willamette, the Snake, and Kootenay Lake. The boats, initially powered by burning wood, carried passengers and freight throughout the region for many years. Early railroads served to connect steamboat lines interrupted by waterfalls on the river's lower reaches. In the 1880s, railroads maintained by companies such as the Oregon Railroad and Navigation Company and the Shaver Transportation Company began to supplement steamboat operations as the major transportation links along the river, opening the passage to Lewiston as early as 1881. Industrialists proposed altering the natural channel of the Columbia to improve navigation. Changes to the river over the years have included the construction of jetties at the river's mouth, dredging, and the construction of canals and navigation locks. Today, ocean freighters can travel upriver as far as Portland and Vancouver, and barges can reach as far inland as Lewiston, Idaho. The shifting Columbia Bar makes passage between the river and the Pacific Ocean difficult and dangerous, and numerous rapids along the river hinder navigation. Pacific Graveyard, a 1964 book by James A. Gibbs, describes the numerous shipwrecks near the mouth of the Columbia. Jetties, first constructed in 1886, extend the river's channel into the ocean strong. Currents and the shifting sandbar remain a threat to ships entering the river and necessitate continuous maintenance of the jetties. In 1891, the Columbia was dredged to enhance shipping. The channel between the ocean and Portland and Vancouver was deepened from 17 feet 52. The Essayons, one of three Army Corps of Engineers dredgers tasked with ongoing maintenance of the Columbia's shipping channel, began service in 1983. Efforts to maintain and improve the navigation channel have continued to the present day. In 1990, a new round of studies examined the possibility of further dredging on the lower Columbia. The plans were controversial from the start because of economic and environmental concerns. In 1999, Congress authorized deepening the channel between Portland and Astoria from 40. Are paying $27. The development of the nation's rivers. This prompted agencies to conduct the first formal financial analysis of hydroelectric development. The reports produced by various agencies were presented in House document. Construction of the dam at Priest Rapids in the 1960s, the United States and Canada signed the Columbia River Treaty, which focused on flood control and the maximization of downstream power generation. Canada agreed to build dams and provide reservoir storage, and the United States agreed to deliver to Canada one half of the increase in U.S. concluded, or a United States senator nears election time in that sense. It is reliable Timothy Egan, in the Irrigation. Prominent dams of the Columbia River Basin. Color indicates dam ownership. Then 670. The Columbia's heavy flow and extreme elevation drop over a short distance, 216 feet per mile 409. Companies like Google have begun to move server farm operations into the area to avail themselves of cheap power downriver of Grand Coulee. Each dam's reservoir is closely regulated by the Bonneville Power Administration (BPA), the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers, and various Washington public utility districts to ensure flow, flood control, and power generation objectives are met. Increasingly, hydropower operations are required to meet standards under the U.S. Endangered Species Act and other agreements to manage operations to minimize impacts on salmon and other fish, and some conservation and fishing groups support removing four dams on the lower Snake River, the largest tributary of the Columbia. In 1941, the BPA hired Oklahoma folk singer Woody Guthrie to write songs for a documentary film promoting the benefits of hydropower. In the month he spent traveling the region, Guthrie wrote 26 songs, which have become an important part of the cultural history of the region. Ecology and environment. Fish migration. See also, environmental impacts of reservoirs. Signing salmon on the Columbia River, 1914. In their natural life cycle, salmon die shortly after spawning. Eagle Creek in Oregon, November 2007. The Columbia supports several species of anadromous fish that migrate between the Pacific Ocean and freshwater tributaries of the river. Sockeye salmon, coho and chinook, also known as king salmon and steelhead, all of the genus Oncorhynchus, are ocean fish that migrate up the rivers at the end of their life cycles to spawn white sturgeon, which take 15 to 25. Varying degrees at allowing these fish to travel upstream. Another problem exists for the juvenile salmon headed downstream to the ocean. Previously, this journey would have taken 2 to 3 weeks with river currents slowed by the dams, and the Columbia converted from wild river to a series of slackwater pools. The journey can take several months, which increases the mortality rate in some cases. The Army Corps of Engineers transports juvenile fish downstream by truck or river barge. The Chief Joseph Dam and several dams on the Columbia's tributaries entitled entirely block migration, and there are no migrating fish on the river above these dams. Sturgeon have different migration habits and can survive without ever visiting the ocean in many upstream areas cut off from the ocean by dams. Sturgeon simply live upstream of the dam. Not all fish have suffered from the modifications to the river. The northern pike minnow, formerly known as the squawfish, thrives in the warmer, slower water created by the dam's research in the mid-1980s found that juvenile salmon were suffering substantially from the predatory pike minnow, and in 1990, in the interest of protecting salmon, a bounty program was established to reward anglers for catching pike minnow. In 1994, the salmon catch was smaller than usual in the rivers of Oregon, Washington, and British Columbia, causing concern among commercial fishermen, government agencies, and tribal leaders. U.S. government intervention, to which the states of Alaska, Idaho, and Oregon objected, included an 11-day closure of an Alaska fishery in April 1994. The Pacific Fisheries Management Council unanimously approved the strictest regulations in 18. Removal in the system. Other Columbia Basin dams that have been removed include Condit Dam on Washington's White Salmon River, and the Milltown Dam on the Clark Fork in Montana. Pollution in southeastern Washington, a 50-mile 80. Energy under the oversight of the Washington Department of Ecology and the Environmental Protection Agency. Nearby aquifers contain an estimated 270.